Hey, I hate to interrupt the great conversation that's happening, but it is already 10:30 in the morning, and you guys are the fortunate ones that have figured out life. Way to go. Give yourselves a round of applause. You were able to set your clocks.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Life Church. My name is Grant. I'm one of the pastors here at New Life. And if you've been with us for a while, or if you're brand new here, I want to know who you are. It's very easy for you to sit at home and even be here and walk right past me, and we don't even have a conversation. So the best way for you to do that this morning is to head to our website, fill out a connection card, and let us know that you are here with us this morning. Well, coming up next week, Sunday night, March 20th, we have a prayer and worship night. And we're gonna be praying for those that are unreached. And by unreached, I mean those who have never heard the gospel. So if you're interested in that, we'd love to see you next week. Check out the weekly email for details. But coming up April 10th, if you have served here at New Life Church, we have an appreciation breakfast for you that we would love for you to be a part of. So let us know that you want to come to that. Details are in the weekly email, but also, if you're interested in serving and you haven't served before, we have many serving opportunities. We have served in kids, the tech team, student ministries. There's so many opportunities for you to be involved here at New Life Church, and we want you to be involved here at New Life Church. Not just serving, but also connecting in community, pursuing God. We want to do this together, and hopefully, by doing so, we will reach our world. Welcome this morning. We're glad to have you here. Come worship with us.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome. It's good to see everybody. So this morning is going to be kind of fun. We are doing some, what I want to call some throwback worship songs. If you're my age, so if you're like mid-late 30s and older, you probably will recognize, and you grew up in the church, you probably, yeah, I'm dating myself here. I'm late 30s, almost 40. But if you grew up like 90s to early 2000s, we're going to be hitting some of these songs today. And some of the things that's been on my heart is this thing about just sitting at the feet of Jesus. And a lot of Sundays we come in and it's fantastic. You know, I love to celebrate. I love to, you know, play this thing as loud as I can. And you know, I love to celebrate and get rowdy for Jesus. But there's also times when he calls us just to sit at his feet. And that there's times that he wants to just pour himself out on us. And so this morning, or this last week or so, just in my own personal worship time, I've just been drawn back to some older songs that I grew up with that I just found myself being able to just commune with Jesus. And so my heart and my prayer and our prayer as a team this morning is that we can do that collectively as the church, as the body of Christ, that we can just sit at the feet of Jesus and we can just love on him. We can tell him, I love you, which we're going to have a chance to do that. We're going to be able to say that over and over in one of our songs. But if you find yourself this morning, you know, we got the lights purposely down a little bit. We want to create a little bit more of an intimate setting for everybody. So I encourage you this morning, as we worship and as we sing, we pray against distractions every week, that people can just walk in, that this is holy ground, and that distractions and things from this last week can just fall off, and that we can just sit at the feet of Jesus this morning. So if you want to, I mean, seriously, if you want to sit literally, you can. If you find yourself, you want to kneel, that's totally fine. I know, typically we stay in our seats, but we're opening this up to whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do this morning. So if you want to sit, you want to kneel, if you want to stand, you want to put your arms up and hands raised, if you want to lay down, it doesn't matter. You know, however you want to worship the Lord this morning, we invite you to do so. We want to create that space this morning, okay? All righty. I can't hear anything that's going on but my voice. So anyway, let's get started.
Everyone. Let's lift him up.
My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
So if you've joined us in this room this morning, or you've joined us online, it's Communion Sunday, and so it's an opportunity to sing and worship and know who God is. So I'm encouraging you to grab this right now and hold on to it. If you haven't had the opportunity to get one, we've got one in the back room. We have gluten-free options as well, but we're going to remain standing this morning, or seated, or whatever it is. In fact, if some of you are laying down, stay there. Whatever place that you found this morning, I want us to be thinking about what it was that Jesus did. That he is mighty to save. And he's the only one that can save. He's the only one that could do what it was that he did. And so we come on Communion Sunday to remember that. And we're going to sing a part of another song here in a second. So if you're at home, go ahead and grab elements. Water, juice, bread, cracker, whatever it is. If you're in this space, and I just want us to hold it and think about it. I want us to reflect on it, what it is that Jesus did. We're in this series on image, and we're coming to the end of it at Easter, and we're beginning the idea of relationships starting today. The ultimate form of relationship is loving someone so much that you're willing to die for them, which is exactly what Jesus did, that he loved us so much that he came and died for us and wanted to be in relationship with us for all eternity, which is what he gave us the opportunity to do on the cross. He died and opened up the doorway for us to spend eternity with him. And so this morning, we remember that we lift him up, that we praise him, that he is mighty to save. And so if you're in this space this morning and you believe that Jesus is who he says he is, that he is your savior and Lord, I hope that you will participate with us and that we will remember what it is that Jesus did because of his love for us. And then he challenged us to love others the same. And so whatever space you're in, whether you're seated, whether you're standing, whether you're laying down, hold on to this and remember the love that Christ has for us and what he did that we couldn't do, as we lift his name up and sing a little bit of this next song together.
Jesus, we worship you. Lord, we take time to sit at your feet, to love on you, to sing love songs to you. And Lord, I pray that as we worship you, Lord, would your spirit be released in this place this morning? Lord, would you move in whatever way you see fit in each heart that's here today, in each heart that's watching online. God, we just want to love on you. Draw our hearts closer to you, Lord. May we fall even more in love with you as we sing this next song. We love you.
Jesus, I love you. I love you.
together in relationship with these individuals that had followed him all the way to the end. And that last meal together, he took the bread and he broke it. As he held it up, he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He then took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Each time you drink, do so in remembrance of me." Jesus, we come before you. We thank you. We love you. So grateful for what it is that you've done because you loved us. Greater love has no one than this, that they lay down their life for their friend, which is what you then modeled and did for us. And so I pray that we can remember that as we stand here today, as we celebrate communion, that we're in awe of you and your love for us because you wanted to be with us in relationship for all eternity. And so I pray, Lord, that as we continue to sing this morning, that we remember that. That we focus on you and you alone. Coming before you, grateful for who you are and what you've done. Thank you. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit is like water to my soul. Your home.
God.
Jesus, you be the very air we breathe. May you saturate us, spirit, soul, and body. Lord, we love you so much. Amen. You may be seated.
Kiddos, ages 3 through 5th grade, you are free to go. Woo. Hey, I want to welcome you this morning. My name is Brett. I'm the lead pastor here at New Life. If you joined us late, either in this space or online, we are so glad that you are here today. And I get really excited about Sundays, and I am super grateful for this morning. In fact, I needed that. I needed a space just to kind of be today. I don't know about you, but if you're like me, your life is crazy right now. Anybody else can connect with that? That life is at like hyper speed. We felt like, at least I felt like, January and February took forever. I don't know why, but this year, January and February just felt like they drug on forever. It was cold. It wasn't like extreme cold, but it was cold. There wasn't a whole lot going on. It felt like, and now that we're into March, like next week is March 20th. It's the first day of spring. Did you guys know that? Next week is the first day of spring already, which I can't believe. Yes. Woo! Which means spring is literally here. Like it's literally here. Like next weekend, it is literally here. And yet for the first time today, it actually feels like it. Like I woke up this morning going, oh, spring. Oh, it's going to start warming my heart, I hope, because I've been cold. Like my whole body's been cold. Everything about me has been cold for the last 2 months. But spring is finally here. So what does spring feel like for you? Is it the warm weather? What gets you to a place where you know it's spring? I heard this question the other day on the radio. They were asking a bunch of people, local Minnesotans, what means spring to you in Minnesota? And I was kind of sitting there, and they'd done a poll. And I was thinking, God, what does it mean for spring? What does spring mean to me in Minnesota? Is it the warm weather? Is it the flowers? What is it? And then last weekend, I was reminded exactly what spring looks like in Minnesota. It's this: ice storms. Ice storms just makes it feel like spring, right? Doesn't it just warm your heart, like nice and fuzzy inside? In fact, this is my deck after what happened last weekend. I don't know if I've ever seen the icicles quite that way. There was just torrential rain followed by cold, and then there was snow on top of that. It was weird. And yet I'm sitting there going, does that mean that there's hope for something new? Does that mean that something is coming? Does that mean warm weather is on the horizon? Because it was rain. It wasn't just snow. Well, that's not what local Minnesotans said makes it feel like spring. Instead, what the number one answer was in this poll has to do with this little yellow thing back here. Anybody see what that is? It's a birdhouse. It's a birdhouse. The number one answer for individuals in Minnesota as to what makes it feel like spring are birds. Birds. The birds are back. Which, when that was said, I was like, oh, yeah, that totally makes sense. I was outside doing some yard work a couple days ago, and guess what I heard? Birds. Birds. They were chirping and tweeting, which makes the Masters that much more exciting because, you know, they pump in those fake bird sounds while you're watching golf, which they've actually denied. They don't pump in. Those are real birds. But there's birds. Birds are coming back, including the nastiest birds of all time. Geese. I saw them flying overhead just this morning on my way to church, which just makes you cringe because, you know, when birds come, guess what else comes with them? Babies, babies, baby birds. Ducks are going to have babies. Geese are going to have babies. And the geese are going to walk across Radio Drive really, really slow. And they're going to have their babies. And you're going to feel guilty if you were to drive right through them. But stop. Don't feel guilty. Just go. Just do it. Hit them. In fact, every time I see a dead goose on the side of the road, I cheer a little bit inside my car. Just a golf clap, though. Just a golf clap. Just like, nice job. Way to go, whoever did that. Because I can't bring myself to do it, but I so want to. Get off the road! Oh! And that's spring. Birds are coming back. They're bringing their babies, including in that yellow birdhouse in my backyard. When it gets warm enough, I'm going to sit on my deck, and there's going to be a nasty little finch that's going to scream at me every time I go out there. Because there's babies inside that house. Babies are a sign of spring, specifically the babies of birds. But I think it's fun, right? Because we know spring is for babies. We know spring is about life. Spring is about love. Spring is about newness once again. And whether you've thought about it or not, spring is also about something else. Spring is about relationships. Relationships. How so? Well, birds are a perfect example of it. Love is kindled anew in the spring, and babies show up. And so when I think of spring, I also think of relationships. And hopefully now, when you see birds, you will also think of spring as love and relationships. Because as we begin this new part of the series, we're heading to Easter now. We're in the last part of our series. We're talking about relationships as we go into Easter, wrapping up this series on Image that we started in October. We're beginning this section on relationships, and hopefully birds will make you think of relationships as we think about babies, because relationships are super important due to this simple fact. Each and every one of us was created by relationship. Each and every one of us was created by relationship. In fact, we have a saying about birds that reminds us of this, right? The birds and the bees totally makes us think of relationships. And if you're not familiar with that phrase, go ahead and ask your mom and dad. I'm sure they'd love to tell you all about it. We use the phrase birds and the bees to talk about how we came from relationship. Each one of us created by relationship. Now, there are medical ways today to circumvent this, but statistically speaking, if you're hearing me today, it's highly likely that you were created by relationship. At least humanly speaking, anyways. In a theological sense, it's a guarantee that each and every one of us was created by relationship, which is true because the God of the Bible is a relationship. The God of the Bible is a relationship. He's not in a relationship, as that would denote separate beings together, but rather God himself is relationship, continually, all the time. The God of the Bible is relationship, three in one. All human beings then, created in the image of God, which is every single one of us, was created out of this relationship. Therefore, in order to accurately image God, we must be relational beings. We must be in relationship. In fact, we feel it, we understand it, we know it. We are relational beings. We can't be alone. As much as we want to at times, we have to come back to each other. Swiss theologian Karl Barth has done much work in the idea of relationship in connection to the image. Barth's philosophy is explained simply this way. The key to understanding the image of God is found in the us and the our of the creation statement of Genesis 1:26. If you go back to Genesis 1:26, we talked about this extensively in this series. God made us in his image. When he said, let us make mankind, he said, in our image, make them like us. There's a relationship there that is denoted within the very beginning of creation. Genesis 1:26 says that out of that relationship, we were created, human beings, every single one of us. According to Barth, then, this relationship with God and others is the ultimate fulfillment of the image. It's the ultimate fulfillment of Scripture in general as we live out the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. The ultimate fulfillment of the image of God, according to Karl Barth, is that we would live in relationship. That we would love God first, and that we would love others second. This is where Barth actually stops with his understanding of the image. He believes that relationship is the only piece of the image that is still being able to be seen with humankind. I disagree with that. I believe that every part of us somehow images God, which is what we're talking about in this series. But I do agree with Barth that we must include relationships in that. That a part of us imaging God is being in relationship. And so today we're going to discuss this relational aspect of the image. We're going to begin today and we're going to wrap it up at Easter, talking about relationships from here until then. So we must start this part of the series by revisiting two aspects of God that are reflected in the image that we discussed a couple weeks ago. Those two things are this: equality and order. In God, there is equality. In God, there is one ousia, one substance. And yet in that substance, there's three hypostasis, three persons in one. That there's one substance and yet three persons within that substance. If you want to know more about this, you can watch our message on gender roles from a couple weeks ago. But we talked about there being equality and yet order, that God is one. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one. There's equality and yet there is order. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, which is biblically accurate to say them in that order, not denoting one more important than the other, but one as first, second, and third in order. Equal, yet in order. Within us then as humans, we talked about male and female, equal and yet with order. Today we're gonna do the same thing within relationships, equality and yet order. There is equality and order in the relationships that God has given us. Equality, every relational status is equal in the eyes of God. Today we're specifically talking about the primary two that are mentioned in Scripture, being single and being married. And we have to begin with this statement. Every relational status is equal in the eyes of God. Being single and being married are equal. They're equal. There is no relational status in Scripture with those two that is greater than the other. They are the same. These two relational statuses made for the exact same purpose. And that purpose is this. Our relational status is meant to glorify God. Our relational status is meant to glorify God. Regardless of whether you are single or you are married, our status is meant to glorify God. In this equality, then, there's order. If they're equal, there is also order. God has ordered our relational statuses, specifically within single and married, in this order. Can you guess which order it is? Boom! Single first. Single and then married. No surprise, right? Hopefully it's not a surprise. If it is a surprise, then yes, that's exciting because that's what I wanted from this message. That you'd walk away going, no way, Brett. If it's not a surprise, great. Then you're tracking with me. It's in this order on purpose. You are single first. From the very moment you breathe life, guess what? You're not married. Did you know that? You're not married. Single is the way we all begin. Marriage possibly comes later, but is not guaranteed. We're born single, and single has a purpose and design by God for God, which is what we're going to talk about today. Now, as we begin this conversation, I have to make it clear. I don't really understand being single. I don't. My wife and I started dating at 19. I don't have many memories before that. I have a few. I think from like 14 to 19, I've got a few memories. But before 14, my life, I got nothing. I don't really remember what it was like being single. We started dating at 19. We got married at 22. So if you want to know the math there, we've been dating for 21 years and married for 18. So this past year, when we celebrated our 18th anniversary, I was officially married to my wife as long as I had been with my mom and dad, which was mind-blowing for me, that I'd been with somebody else just as long as I'd been with my parents. Now, some of you in here are sitting there going, I'm twice that, or I'm three times that. That even is more mind-blowing. Way to go. Woo! That is exciting. My hope is that I'll get there at some point. That I'll be able to say that I've been married to my wife three times as long as I currently am. That would be amazing. But I share that with you because I don't know much about being single. Good news is, though, Scripture does. Scripture knows a lot about it. And I actually have a surprise guest today that I am going to bring up here in a little bit that's going to join me and talk a little bit about both because they understand being single and being married. So this morning, I'm going to ask you to open with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 6 through 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 6 through 9. If you don't have a Bible, I'd love to give you one. In this space, there's one on a back table. You can grab one hard copy online. You can join us with the Bible app in the room. You can also join us with the Bible app. If you go into the app store, it is a red Bible with white letters. All of these notes will be there with you. If you save them today, you can take them the rest of the week. Just go into extras, events, New Life Church of Woodbury, and we are right there. So we're going to be in 1 Corinthians 7, 6 through 9 today. Read along with me. It says this, now as a concession. So this is Paul speaking. Paul, the disciple of Jesus Christ, is speaking to the Corinthians. Last week, we talked a little bit about the Corinthians living a lifestyle that they shouldn't have been, and so Paul corrects them. And so that's in the chapter right before what we're reading right now. Paul corrects them in their lifestyle of doing things immorally, and now gets into a conversation of how they could do things morally. And so he says this to the Corinthians in chapter 7, starting in verse 6. Now, as a concession, not a command, I say this. I wish that all were as I myself am. But each has his own gift from God, one of one kind and one of another. To the unmarried and the widows, I say that it is good for them to remain single, as I am. But if they cannot exercise self-control, they should marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion. All right, I want to stop right there for a sec. We're going to continue in the rest of 7, but I want to focus on these verses to begin with. Paul has just talked about marriage in the beginning of chapter 7 as a rebuttal to what was happening in chapter 6. They were giving themselves to individuals physically that they shouldn't have been in chapter 6. And so Paul comes into chapter 7 and says, no, the way to do this the right way is to give yourself to each other in marriage. So he talks about marriage at the very beginning of the chapter. Like I said, as a follow-up to the immorality that was happening in chapter 6. The Corinthians were doing whatever they wanted. They were eating whatever they wanted. They were having physical relations with whoever they wanted. And Paul says, stop it. Stop it. You need to cut it out. You can't do that anymore because there's this thing called the resurrection. Your body's going to go with you. It's coming back. That when you die, you're coming back. So be careful what you do. So in 7, he says, if you can't stay away from individuals, if you're burning with passion here on earth, you know what the answer is? Get married. Get married. And then he says, practice monogamy. There's only one person that you should be with, and that's your husband and your wife or your wife. Yet in this passage, Paul then starts talking about an interesting topic right in the middle of the marriage conversation, which I think is quite fascinating. In the middle of marriage, right in the middle of the conversation, he talks about this idea of being single, this concept of singleness. Wrapped up right in the middle of a marriage conversation, Paul provides another perspective. He makes a couple interesting comments regarding this perspective on being single. First, he says this, everyone should be like him. Everyone should be like Paul. Well, what does that mean? Why should everyone be like Paul? And what was it exactly he was asking them to do to be like him? Well, he says this, now as a concession, not a command, I say this, I wish that all were as I myself am. Paul's referring to his relational status. See, we know that Paul was single his whole life. The greatest disciple of Jesus Christ never got married. And so as he's talking to the Corinthians about marriage, he inserts another perspective and says, actually, I wish that you were all like me. Not as a concession, or now as a concession, not a command. So it's not a command. It's a, hey, you should think of something else. There's another perspective to this, that you should be like me. It was another option, not a command that they couldn't get married, but an option that they could stay single. And why would they want to do that? Why would they want to be like him? Because Paul makes it very clear right after that. Singleness is a gift. 1 Corinthians 7, 7b. But each has his own gift from God. One of one kind and one of another. Paul says, I wish you could all be like me because God's given me a gift. Everybody has a gift. The gift that I've been given is the ability to be single. Single. Paul says singleness is a gift. It's a gift because it's a relational status that can uniquely image God. It uniquely images God by being totally devoted to God in relationship only with him. The way that God is devoted in relationship within himself. As God is a relationship within himself, as he is relationship, a single status, the status of singleness, allows us to image God in the way that we can be connected in relationship, primarily and wholly with God himself, just like he is within himself. Often, though, within church culture in the United States, we do not view singleness as a gift. We do not view it as a gift. In fact, I've heard it said a number of times in the church, singleness gets a bad rap. It really does. In fact, I've also heard people somewhat suggest and insinuate that people that are single are less than those that are married, which we have to understand is not true. It should not be the case. As a church, we should not have that view. Singleness is a gift. In fact, one book I read this week put it well when it said this: singleness is not the JV of Christianity. Singleness is not the JV of Christianity. You do not get bumped up to varsity when you get married. Capiche? You do not get bumped up to varsity when you get married. We should not think of people this way. Often, though, we do without even realizing it because it's so ingrained in us that we must be married, that if you are not married, then something must be wrong with you, right? Yes. And this is where it gets really convicting because I can see a bunch of you in this space kind of doing this. Oh, no. Yes. What's one of the first things that married couples do with people that are single? Are you dating? Do you have anybody, any options, anything out there? You're playing the field. What are you doing? No, no. In fact, Paul is looking at a bunch of married people going, ha ha, I wish you were like me. It's so great. And he's going to tell us here in a little bit why it's so great. But he says very beginning here that it's great because it's the first of the order of things. But he's saying this because of good order and that it's a gift for a number of reasons. So why is it a gift? 1 Corinthians 7:32 through 35. I want you to be free from anxieties. The unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to please the Lord, but the married man is anxious about the worldly things, how to please his wife, and his interests are divided. And the unmarried or betrothed woman is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to be holy in body and spirit, but the married woman is anxious about worldly things, how to please her husband. I say this for your own benefit, not to lay any restraint upon you, but to promote good order and to secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. Paul says there are numerous benefits to being single. First one, singleness brings less worries. I want you to be free from anxiety. The unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to please the Lord. And the unmarried or betrothed woman is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to be holy in body and spirit. See, singleness brings less worries. Paul says when you're single, there's only one major thing to worry about, and that's how you are bringing praise to God and how you are pleasing God, which seems extremely simple, right? Not that there aren't other things to worry about when being single, but there isn't another person in your life that you have to worry about other than God. How can you please God? Not saying that you should be single because you want to be selfish. That's not the case at all. In fact, rather, I can be selfless in a way that I can't be when I'm married. Singleness provides a space to be more others-focused than those that are married. When you are married, you have a select few people that you must think about, such as your immediate family. Whereas when you are single, you can help many different people. Singleness also brings less distraction and trouble. But those who marry will face many troubles in this life, and I want to spare you of this. But the married man is anxious about worldly things, how to please his wife, and his interests are divided. But the married woman is anxious about worldly things, how to please her husband. There are a plethora of things in this life that we could name that make us anxious when we are married. Specifically, though, as Paul calls it out, that we've got to please somebody else. That we have to take somebody else's interests in mind. Think through all these questions. Simple things like, what should we have for dinner? Oh, I saw a meme the other day that said, who would have thought that the toughest thing about adult life is figuring out what to eat every night? It's so hard. What am I going to have for dinner? And then you add another person in. You know how many little fights we've gotten in our house when my wife goes, what do you want for dinner? And I'm like, I don't care. And she goes, no, tell me. I'm like, it's fine, whatever you want. And then she makes something, and I'm like, oh, that? Oh. Yes, when you're single, you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to worry about what you're going to eat. You can go do whatever you want. You can eat whatever you want. Do you stay in? Do you go out? If you go out, where do you go? You don't have to worry about the other person or how you spend your time. When you're married, how should we spend our time? Is it focused on us? Is it focused on others? Do we have friends as individuals or as a couple or both? Can I go on guys' trips or girls' trips? Do I have to keep track of how many guys' trips I go on so you can equally have as many girls' trips? It's so difficult. Who takes care of the finances? How do we spend our money? What side of the family do we go to for what holidays? Should we have kids? Can we have kids? If we do have kids, how do we raise them? And what about retirement? What happens when the kids are gone? If we did have kids, what do we do now? Where do we live? Do we live by them? Do we not live by them? There's a lot of worries when you're married, which I could go on. But I won't, because you get the idea. Last benefit of being single. Singleness allows us to be totally devoted to God. 1 Corinthians 7:32. I want you to be free from anxieties. The unmarried man is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to please the Lord. The unmarried or betrothed woman is anxious about the things of the Lord, how to be holy in body and spirit. Then he ends in 35. I say this for your own benefit, not to lay any restraint upon you, but to promote good order and to secure your undivided devotion to the Lord. As I told you at the beginning of this message, I don't understand singleness. I got married at 22. I started dating my wife at 19. I've been in a relationship now with her for more years than I haven't. Therefore, I really can't speak to this topic with much personal experience. There is someone, though, I want to introduce you to this morning that can. Someone that I know fairly well that can speak to both sides of this issue. And I wanted to interview her this morning. So I'm going to ask her to join me this morning. Will you guys welcome up my sister-in-law, Larissa Lilly? So I say sister-in-law, which immediately denotes the fact that you're married. So you are married to my brother, Curtis, and currently live in Washington, which is where you're from, correct? Can you share a little bit about your background and where you grew up?
Yeah. Hi, all. My name is Larissa Lilly. Like Brett said, I am from Eastern Washington, a tiny little town, 500 people. Grew up on a wheat and barley farm along with Iris, so 1,600 acres. With an immediate family of mom, dad, sister, and brother. So grew up there, continued to college. Should I go there?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Continued to college in California at a Christian university. And then ended up pursuing my master's at Seattle University in higher education. So I really wanted to pursue working with college students, which is what I do now. I'm the Associate Dean of Students at Northwest University, which is Assemblies of God College in Kirkland, Washington. Love it. And I've been a lot of places, which I can speak to now or I can pause.
Yeah, I think you should pause because you made an interesting statement when you welcome or when you said hi to everybody. You used the phrase y'all.
Yes.
Is that a Eastern Washington, Seattle thing?
Not necessarily.
No. Yep. Okay.
I have worked in Texas for a number of years, 6 years. And I think y'all just came on because it's so inclusive of everyone, right? I don't have to say, hey, you guys, which is what we say in Washington. Hey, guys. Well, where's our women in that, right? Ooh, so, hey, yes. Y'all is very inclusive.
Right. Totally relevant to the conversation we've been having the last couple of weeks. Yeah. So, right. I would encourage all of you guys to start saying y'all, all right?
That's
Can
right.
we do that? It's much more inclusive. Y'all. Hey, y'all. I think when I was in New York, it's use guys.
Yes.
So,
yeah.
Use guys.
Definitely on the East Coast.
Yeah. So, yeah. We can start saying y'all.
Yeah.
So your background, though, is that you got the opportunity to do a number of different things. So you're currently in Seattle, in the position that you have. But prior to that, you kind of bounced around a little bit. Can you share a little bit about what that looked like?
Yeah. When I was in grad school, I asked the Lord for an RD, resident director position, in the South at a small Christian school. Those were kind of my qualifications. And I said, if I don't get it by May 1st, I'm going to open it up. Well, on May 2nd, I was offered a job at a school in Texas. And so I was a resident director there. Again, small Christian school for 3 years with all females. And then was able to kind of continue my journey, right? And I will kind of allude to this. Like, as a single person, I didn't have to think about what's my husband going to do if I move on. So I was able to be just so open-handed for where the Lord was calling me. And though all of my changes in positions that I'll kind of talk about really have to do with my job, I really view it as a ministry, right? It's a Christian atmosphere, Christian college with college students. That's kind of like my heartbeat is, man, how do I get a minister to these young men and women? But was in the South for 3 years, again, open-handed. Okay, Lord, where do you want me next? Moved up to Philadelphia for a year. Then back to Texas for almost 3 years. And finally, again, continuing to be open-handed, the Lord moved me back to Washington. Never thought I would live in Washington again. Never thought I would work at the university that I'm actually working at. And it has just been incredible. But have been able to kind of journey around the entire United States for the last 13 years, plus college, because of, honestly, a lot of it does go with my singleness because I didn't have the worries that Brett was kind of alluding to earlier, right? I didn't have a family. I didn't have children. And so I was able just to say, where do you want me, Lord? And was able to do that.
Yeah, and I want to highlight about that, about Larissa's story. Like, she has shared in numerous different settings and obviously personally that, you know, she was totally devoted. God, where do you want me to go? And she viewed Christian education, specifically higher ed, as the place that God had put her so that she could be in ministry and impact lives. And if we had time today, which we don't, we'd be able to share all of the stories of the individuals that Larissa has come in contact with, that she meets with regularly. In fact, she came into town here and went and met with a friend in the cities that she's connected with through this journey and has really had the ability to just say, okay, God, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? Couple years here, a couple years there, a couple years here. So that whole time you were able to devote, what was life like single compared to being married? We'll get into your married here in a minute.
Sure.
But what was life like before you were married?
Free, right? Totally undevoted to whatever was available to me, any opportunity, right? And as I think about just the ways I was able to spend my time, my money, my resources, I didn't have to be home at 5 o'clock because my husband was going to be home and my kids were going to be home, right? If there was a student that needed extra care or attention or conversation, I was able to do that. And so the mentorship that I was able to have, especially with young women, of them kind of going through this journey of knowing the Lord or growing the Lord, coming to find the Lord wherever they were at, I was able to kind of say, my time is open, my home is open, the amount of students I had over to my home for dinners or coffee or hangout, you know, that was just so open. I was able to kind of sacrificially serve in that way. Now, we try to do that now that we're married, right? But it looks really different because we have to think about, how are we doing this together? And I know you said we'll get into that. But like, I think just really open, right? As a single person, you get to kind of just say, Lord, where do you want me? Not only locationally, but on the day-to-day life. Can I stay extra at work? Or can I go do this event? Or can I do this thing with this person? Whatever that is, you get to be free from any expectation of others, whether those are stated or not stated sometimes. And you just get to do what the Lord has called you to and where you kind of feel yourself running to in those days and in those years of singleness.
Okay, so while that was happening, did you want to get married? Did you, I guess another part of that question is, did you ever feel pressure?
Yeah.
To get married? Did you feel like, oh, hey, I'm doing this now, but if I get to my 30s, oh, people are going to think something's wrong with me?
Right.
Did you ever experience any of that?
Right. Well, and that's why I want to start by saying, this is why I love talking about singleness. Even Curtis, sometimes my husband, he's like, you know that you're married now, right? And I'm like, yes, I am. And I love marriage. marriage, but I love singleness. I think, like Brett was alluding to, right, I was someone that enjoyed singleness. And I think so often people don't enjoy it. They think it is a burden, right, or this like the JV side of things. But I loved singleness and really was able to fully enjoy it. Did I have seasons where I felt like I wanted to be married? Yes. Sometimes, not only did I want to be married, I just wanted to have kids. And you had to have a husband, really, to do that, right? But I wanted to be married
biblically.
Yes, biblically. True. Yes. Yeah. But there was definitely seasons where I wanted that. And I think the pressure, that's, you know, a big thing, especially in the South. Many women go to college for their MRS degree. Right? And for women specifically, those college girls to see me as someone that was like strong and confident and career driven, they thought I was crazy at times. And you know, you kind of get the question, well, why are you single? You're so cool. You're so blank. Well, if that was a qualification, yeah, I'd be married, right? But that's not what it is, right? The Lord had called me to singleness in that season. And I think especially in the church, there's such this cultural idea and pressure to get married, to be that wife, to be a mom, to be all of those things. And I think that as a church, Big C Church, like we have to do better in embracing single men and women as part of our communities, because not everybody is called to get married, you know, and I'm thankful that I did get to get married and am married. But if I was single still, I think I would hope I'd be okay with that, right? Like, I think that there's this contentment that I finally had to kind of agree with the Lord on, like, okay, Lord, this is a season that you've called me to, and it may last way longer than I anticipated, but that's going to be okay. And I think if I can just say one more thing, if you're in that single status, if you will, if you say, like, I'm in this season of waiting, well, I think then your motivation in your heart is so focused on the marriage part of it that you're really not able to be fully content with where you are if you're just in the season of waiting for that significant other to come into your life. And so if I can just encourage you to, like, pursue the Lord, like, go all in. This is the time you can do it, because as I can speak to you, like, you cannot do that as a married individual or couple to the same extent that you are able to as a single person. So don't just be in the season of waiting. Be in the single, or be in the season of, like, pursuit and going all in.
So we'll transition a little bit into the marriage piece. You haven't been my sister-in-law for very long. How many years?
Almost five. Yes, and I have 3 children in 5 years.
Which, we actually have a picture of that. If you take a look at this, this is where Larissa's current state of life is at.
Crazy.
So, typically, you don't ask someone their age, so I'm not going to ask you your current age, but you were a single professional for 10-plus years. How old were you when you got married?
I was 32 years old, but if you do the math, I'm 37 years old. Yeah, so 32 years. Curtis and I met, and 8 months later, we were married.
Right.
So 31 met, 32 married.
Right. Yeah. And you're both the same age?
We're both the same age.
Both same age when you got married. So my brother knows a little bit about being single as well, too. You have heard him speak before. You hadn't heard from Larissa yet, so I thought her perspective would be a little bit different. You can also ask my brother Curtis about what it means to be single. And now also married, which I thought was interesting, because you can kind of do the, you know, there's the compare and contrast that you can do between the two. So what's different now about being married? Let's talk about blessings, right?
Lots
the good
of
things
them. Yes.
About being married that you weren't able to do when you were single.
Yeah, so many blessings. I am so grateful to be married to the best Lily man, Curtis.
Highly debated.
We were all meant for the particular Lilies that we married. But I'm really so grateful.
Amen.
For Curtis. Yes. Star is just the woman for Brett. But I'm so grateful for Curtis. I think, you know, marriage and family has been very quick, like I alluded to. You know, 5 months after we married, we found out that we were having a baby, which was really exciting, but a lot of life has happened in that time. So the blessings, I think, though, are like doing life together. You know, I'm so grateful that as Curtis and I spent so many years single in kind of different areas of ministry, right? Mine was really college focused. His was really youth focus. Now, granted, those are all like students, which was great. We now have the opportunity to minister together. Like the amount of times that we have both kind of sides of our ministries, church, he's now a pastor. And so our church family, as well as my college students, over to our home to be able just to live life with people. We get to do that together. And I think that's something that's really special, is doing ministry together. Thankful that the Lord has kind of matched up our hearts in that way, especially because we're both kind of on our own career paths. I think also raising a family, it is, for me, very sanctifying daily to be married and raise a family and learn how to parent a teenager who has a lot of attitude, you know? So I think those things are really beautiful in the marriage side of things. Praying together, holding each other accountable. I mean, there's times that he's even said to me, like, babe, I want to give you more time with the Lord, because it is very difficult when you're raising babies and waking up in the middle of the night, as I'm sure so many of you can speak to way more than I can, to like actually spend quality time with the Lord at different parts. And so I'm so grateful for those blessings of marriage. And then I think the hard stuff is so much of what you talked about. And again, I think you have so many more like anxieties than even I do, because I have 3 and under. But the time commitment, I mean, where are we going to spend our time? Where are we going to spend our money? Where are we going to spend our resources? How are we going to do this together? All of those things, I think, take over our thoughts and our time. What are we going to have for dinner? Who's going to be a part of our calendar in the upcoming weeks? Curtis is someone, I really value this, but he does not let me work later than I want to work. So I'm someone that like loves to work. And he's like, babe, it's 5 o'clock and we need you home. And not that like dinner on the table, he's not that type of person, but like we want to spend time as a family. And so that type of just, again, sacrificial serving to my husband and to our family is something that has sanctified me, I think, over and over again.
All right, so the $1 million question, is one better than the other?
I think the easy answer, right, or everyone thinks like yes, in some ways, like culturally, but I would say no. Like, I think Curtis and I both, I can say this, like, grieve singleness sometimes, grieve those opportunities that we have. I think both are beautiful in their own way. And what Curtis and I always talk about is that your mission does not change. Single to married, your mission stays the same. And like you said, that is to glorify the Lord, right? But no, both are beautiful in their own separate and distinct ways.
Yeah. I think that's what's been really interesting, being an outsider looking in, watching my brother and Larissa and hearing their stories and seeing how God used them when they were single and now is using them together. It's the same, but different, very different. And what's tough is when we start putting right or wrong on one or the other. It's not right. It's not wrong. It's different. It's different. And God upholds both of them and says, as a single person, you don't have the worries you do as a married person. You can seek after me and come find me wholeheartedly in a way you can't when you're married. And yet when you're married, you can minister and do things differently than you can when you're single. And yet both are meant to glorify God. So, well, thank you very much, Larissa, for joining us. Can you guys give her a round of applause? So one is not better than the other. As a single person, like I said, I can participate in the relationship of God himself in a direct and devoted way that I cannot do as a married person. I can show the world God's love by giving of myself the way that Paul and Jesus did. I can devote my whole life, my whole work, and all that I have to God in a way that I cannot do in any other type of relationship. Therefore, this morning, we can say it matters, because singleness gives the ability for undivided devotion to the Lord as I image and glorify him. Being single matters. Being single matters because it gives us the ability to image God in a way that marriage can't. So here's the challenge this morning for the church. Challenge: how can I uphold singleness as a value and encourage those around me that are single? How can I uphold it as a value and encourage others around me that are single? So here's what I'm asking you to do. As you're talking to somebody who is not married, do not ask them when they are going to get married. Do not ask if they are dating. Rather, ask them, what's God doing in your life right now? How is God using you? How can I support you? How can we come together? Because we need to be in relationship. And Paul says, I wish that everyone could be as I. He encourages being single, not because he's restraining or constraining others from getting married, but because of how it images the devotion of God in himself and shows the love of God to this world as you can be solely devoted, wholly connected to him. We then must encourage the same. So today, if you can be like Paul, do it. Do it. Paul does go on, though, and encourages marriage and says, if your calling is to do that, then do it well. So how does marriage glorify and image God? That's a really great question that we'll answer next week. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this opportunity to talk about relationships, to wrestle through scripture, and to see that you've designed both the ability for us to be single and the ability for us to be married. And yet both of them to glorify you, Lord. So I pray right now for all of those in this space that are single, that they will glorify you in all that they do. That those in the space that are married, that we will encourage those that are solely devoted, sold out for you, Lord, in their season, whatever that may be, that they're not waiting, that they're actively participating, and that we can be a community together in relationship, all different relational statuses, focused on you so that we can glorify you in all that we do. Our hope as a church is to help people find new life in Christ. And so I pray that we can do that and understand that, Lord, however you have us right now, whatever our relational status is, that it's meant to glorify you in all that we do. So when the world sees us, they see you through us. We thank you. We praise you, Lord. We are so grateful for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you please stand for one last song before we close out the service?
serve a holy God that we come and celebrate on Sundays, but we should celebrate every day of the week. And what's beautiful about this God that has made us in his image, and there's nothing he's created that relegates us to lesser status when it comes to glorifying him. All of the things ordained and created by God, given to us, are meant to image him, so the world will see him through us. So this week, be devoted, be sold out, regardless of where you're from, regardless of where you've been, regardless of where you're going. God's got a call on your life. And the things that he's created, his call is that each and every one of us will image and glorify him in all that we do. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity. We pray as we leave this space today, as we shut off the online stream, that we will go wherever it is that you have us to go, and that we will glorify you in all that we do through all aspects of how you have created us. You have given us these different things, Lord. You've given us our ethnicity. You've given us our gender. You've given us our relational status. And in each one of those, you have said, use it to its fullest. Be devoted to you and glorify you in all of it. And so I pray that we can, as beings made in your image, as image-bearing creatures, I pray that we will leave this space today and so glorify you in all that we do, that when the world sees us, they will see you through us. We thank you. We praise you. We give it all to you. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. See you guys next weekend.
So as Pastor Brett mentioned today, as we've been talking about the image of God, you are created in God's image, and God has a plan for your life. Whether you're married or whether you're single, both glorify God. If you have any questions about today, please reach out to us. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls.
Activate us now. We are your church. We need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives. For you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released. The hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. We are your church. We pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your your kids.